Then you will receive. You're ready for revival. Nothing. Hallelujah. I wish somebody would get caught up this morning. Ooh, my, my. This earth, he did many things for many people that were withered hands stretched forth, blind eyes that had never seen anything. Touched them once, they saw men as trees walking. Touched them again, they were made whole. He found himself seated at Simon's house, and in she walked. Not invited, nor welcome. But what she brought with her was more important than anything that was on the table already. I don't find anywhere in there where she got distracted by the whispers as she walked. I don't find anywhere in there where she almost turned around because of what someone said that offended her. Her mind was made up. I didn't come for you. I came for him. And there at his feet, she began to pour upon him an ointment for his burial, but even more important than that, and the price of that ointment, was the tears that come out of her eyes, because Simon didn't wash his feet, but she never ceased to, and she dried them with her hair. And I feel something in this place that God's tired of begging many, and he's done with most. But there are some gathered in this tabernacle this morning that are wading through the crowd, could care less what you think or what you're going to say about them in regards to the measure of worship that they're going to pour upon him today. Some of you came because you're hungry. Some of you came because you're thirsty. Not so God would give you a get out of jail free card or would make your misery subside in this moment. You have resided in your heart that he is enough. So I'm going to do something a little different today. I'm not going to pet you in your little needs today, because we've done that for long enough. And some of you come with the same ones because you won't make him the most important. But I wonder, are there seated or standing in this place those that want the Lord of hosts to come reside among us this morning? And if that is your request, I want you to step out from where you're standing. Now, we're not going to call on the elders this morning. We've been doing that. And some are no different, because they don't want to be healed and they don't want to be lifted up off the bed that they're now seated on right now. But there are some in this place today that you're going to momentarily forget about those little woes of life and rituals that many of you have been a part of for a long time, more than we want to confess. But I wonder right now, just for a moment, that we can make this prayer service and the portion of this service about him right now. Come, lift your hands where you're standing right now. Get beyond the misery and the woes of life and get caught up in this moment right now. God is seated on the throne, but he wonders, are we going to bend and bow and worship him and make him enough if I never see promise? Make him enough if I never get healed, if I never get up from where I am. God, you are absolutely enough right now. Hallelujah, right where you're standing. Lose all track of time, thought processes. Quit worrying about the problem and make it about praise right now. And let the Lord of hosts interrupt your thinking right now. And your woe is me, I'm undone. Let it become about worship, worship, worship right now is how we war around here in Jesus' name. I just want you, God. You're the most important in my life. If I never come out of this with lifted hands like Jacob of old, leaning on my cane, I'm going to worship you this morning. I'm going to praise you. my last service. I'm going to go to heaven from this moment, God. And I'm going to make the best of it, Lord, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, let your voices be heard in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. God knows you need healing, but he knows you need to worship. He knows worship needs to transpire in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I wish some of you'd push through the crowd right now. Push beyond who will and who won't, who's here, not here. It doesn't matter. He's here this morning. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. From this service today, chastisement will arise because he will look to the Simons. But it won't be long. He'll look beyond the Simons and look to her. I don't even know what her name is, but he did. And he was caught up in not just what she brought, but the moment. I hadn't seen this in a while, he said. And it's happening right now among us right now. Some of you have wrapped your mind around like Isaiah of old when he said, I'm unclean. I'm in the midst of unclean people. But Jesus looked beyond that and he said, I'm just looking for a man and a woman that will get beyond themselves and be sent from this place today and understand we have but a little time and a little space to get in this harvest before grace is dissipated because the dispensation is over. And I wish you'd get caught up and eclipsed by his presence beyond the woes of life. And some have willingly participated in, but the worshipers are in the place this morning. Come on, I don't care if this is your first time here or last time. I wish you'd help me worship him right now. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. We want you, God. That's our request today. That's the only thing we bring to the table this morning. It's about you, Lord. We're not moving beyond you. Looking to you, God, just to get over, get up, and get out. But if I never do, you're enough, God. You don't owe me one thing this morning, but I owe you everything. In the name of Jesus. I wish you'd clap your hands unto him right now. In the name of Jesus. I wish some of you'd go ahead and shout and worship right now with a voice of triumph. In Jesus' name, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. For you that have willingly placed yourself at the feet of worship, you're going to get up from this. Hallelujah, God's going to make sure. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Return to your seat for just a moment. And I want Brother Destin to come and tell us what's going on around Sunday school for the next few weeks and months. God bless you. Give him your attention.
Praise the Lord. I love Sunday school. Those kids are a lot of fun most of the time. We'll be having about just a few more children's choir practices in preparation for Easter. That's Sundays and Wednesdays. Please have your children here early enough. That way we can practice and we'll be prepared. The next thing, everyone say Pickle Sunday. That is April 2nd, and it's going to be a good time. We'll have sour pickles, we'll have, which aren't the good kind for me, and then we'll have the good kind of pickles, the other kind of pickles. I really love the sweet ones as well. Those things are good, sweet gherkins or whatever they're called. And it's going to be a great time, amen? How many of you love your kids? Amen. Have them here. Thank you, Lord.
Lord. There it is. That's a little better. Everyone say youth. Say power hour. Say fun. Fun and games. Power hour this Wednesday, you guys. You don't want to miss it. We got brand new games that... It involves peanut butter and tic-tac-toe and possibly getting smacked in the face with peanut butter. So you don't want to miss it. If you're part of the youth, it's going to be fun. Just a little hint right there. Also, we have Move the Mission. Move the Mission. Praise the Lord. Come on. Move the Mission. Move the Mission is for missionaries outside of the U.S. as well as inside the U.S. I've got those cans. I've got a few more. I've got to get one to someone over here, and I'll get you one if you'd like one. You fill the cans up with penny, nickel, dimes, and what that's going to do is it's going to help push forward and move that mission. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
I'll say it again. Praise the Lord. Hyphen Young Adults, we are going to have outreach March 30th. This is this Tuesday on campus at 6 o'clock. We will meet at the Honors Hall courtyard, just because that's like a central area. It's come expecting. Let's invite people, especially to this upcoming Easter service. Some young people may not go to church. Like you say, some people may never go to church except for Easter. And for another one, I can't remember. We're going to have Bible study, Hyphen Bible study, Sunday, April 17th at 6:30. We had it, last week? We're going to have it again in a couple of weeks, about once a month. Come expecting for that, too. Come hungry. We're going to feed y'all. Praise the Lord.
Everybody's having your peace. Say anchor. Anchor. Anchor is this week. I believe it's bearing fruit. If you want to know more about it, you need to get to where the pastor, he teaches. It's excellent class, and I don't think you would be disappointed. Prayer meeting. Prayer meeting. We have prayer every Saturday night. Every Saturday night. The first Saturday night of the month is designated as church-wide prayer, and we ask that if you consider this your church, if this is your church home, that you at least try to make that one. At least try to make that one. It is essential. I've said it often, and I'm going to say it again today. Saturday night prayer sets the tone for Sunday morning service. If this is your week to clean, please don't forget. Please don't forget. We want to keep the house of the Lord looking good. Easter. Everybody knows what Easter is. It is probably the most attended service of the year, right up there with Mother's Day. We need candy-filled eggs. Now, if each family could bring at least 2 dozen filled with candy, not chocolate. Chocolate melts in the sun. And extra candy would be great as well. May the 20th is a men's spring retreat. We host it. We've had it the past couple of years. It's going to start at 9 a.m. here at the church for breakfast and a worship service, and that is always my favorite part of the whole retreat. Now, I don't shoot, don't hold it against those that do, because somehow or another I always wind up with deer meat, and I love that stuff. But if you shoot, there's going to be a skeet shoot, there's a pistol shoot, there will be prizes awarded. There's going to be lunch, tickets are $20, and can be purchased online. Everybody get real quiet for a minute. This Saturday, 7:30 in the morning, is a work day. And for those in the back that might not have heard me, this Saturday at 7:30 in the morning is a work day. We'll start at 7:30 and we'll work until. Get you back standing to your feet. Also, in light of the Easter service coming up, we need a little extra money. And if this is your church, kind of embarrasses me that I have to ask you for it. But we got to do some touch-up. We got to do some prepping. I don't know if you noticed the difference in the doorway going to the Sunday school room. The baptistry is in the room that it's going to be at. We've built part of the floor. That is a brand-new baptistry. It's never been used. And we're just that excited me just to get it that far. And we got plans to finish that. We have 4 ways to give here at Life Church. You can do it online. The link is on the screen. Text to give. The phone number is up there. If you're going to do it in person, can I get my ushers, please? Those that help me take up the offering. If you're going to do it in person, please begin to make your way to the front, bringing your offerings, your tithes, your gifts to God. We also have Cash App. That makes it easier on our secretary. She has said multiple times. And she has enough to do, being a public school teacher and secretary for this church and running her family. So if y'all can, make it easy on her.
Why don't you step across the aisle real quick and shake somebody's hand and tell them you're glad they're here. Tell them they look nice. If they don't, just ask God to forgive you. He will. And praise the Lord. Real quickly, where's Brother Ivan and Sister Haley Pierman? Y'all come here real quick. And these two graduated our Fruits Discipleship class recently. And I want to honor them today and let them know how much we appreciate. I'll come up here in front and center and look all nice and pretty right here on camera for everybody out there in the internet land. And just want to say thank you for sticking it out with me. Why don't we give these amazing disciples a great big hand? God's been good to us. We love them. And they are faithful and work hard. And I appreciate their consistency. And real quick, we do have pickle cards. We do have Easter cards. They have QR codes, which make it simple. I don't know if you've been to the new website, but it's very user-friendly. And you might want to scan that QR. If you don't know what a QR code is, never mind. Or get with somebody that does. And there is, I want to say something. There is no excuse to not know what goes on around here. Yeah, well, yeah. Let me say that again for those. There's no excuse to not know what goes on around here. You with me? And I want to pastor just for about 2 seconds, and then I'm going to get into this. It's good. Don't worry. I want to tell the hungry right now, don't let the satisfied kill you. Because God's looking for hunger. You with me? I'm going to leave that alone. Last night in this place, I believe, was the sweetest presence of God that I've felt in a long time. It wasn't hard fought for. We didn't have to toil in our tarrying. It was as if he knew we were working and he could not wait until 6 o'clock, because unity had been exhibited around this place all day long. Missions were accomplished. And last night, as a result of that, ministry took place in this house. And I want to thank you. If you were on machines or raking leaves or painting or fixing ACs, whatever you were doing around this place, I just want to tell you, thank you very, very, very much. Praise the Lord. Put your Bibles down just for a moment. We're going to get into it in a minute, I promise. But you know I'm somewhat unorthodox. But I want to pray first. I'm going to let you sit down, and then I'll tell you where we're headed. So y'all pray with me right now. Spirit of the living God, you sought us out last night in this place. And God, today, I pray that you would meet with us before we leave here today, because I feel like that the hungry are among us. And we pray this in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Clap your hands unto him one more time. And you may be seated in Jesus' name. Today, for lack of a better term, I want to preach to you the sound the hungry make. You with me? The sound the hungry make. Jesus had enough of the Jews at Jerusalem. It's not hard to see why. They were pious and pompous, and they thought they had Father Abraham around the nape of his neck, but they didn't realize that Abraham on Mount Sinai had already got a glimpse of something greater than himself. In parting to Tyre and Sidon, he said, "You know what the problem is with you?" He said, "You draw nigh to me with your mouth and you honor me with your lips, but your heart and actions are far from me." Verse 16 of the same setting, he kind of had a little bless your heart moment. He said, "Are you without understanding?" Now, where I come from, that's just a kind way of saying, "Are you stupid?" And he said, "Do you not know that the God of human flesh is amongst you?" He didn't say it, but he said it with his actions. And as he rolled up onto Tyre and Sidon, there was a woman of Canaan that began to cry out unto him, and she wasn't polite, and she probably wouldn't have been politically acceptable, but she cried out to him, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me." Then she went right into her needs. I know we're taught to enter his gates with thanksgiving. And we are taught on this side to enter his courts with praise. And as any king, as you begin to praise him in the outer courts, the scepter is extended and he allows you to come into the inner courts. But she bypassed the protocol of the kingdom. She said, my daughter is grievously vexed with the devil, but the Bible said he ignored her. Now, how rude. And he didn't just ignore her. He didn't even give her time, attention, didn't look her way. Didn't answer her a word, my Bible said. Even his very disciples that were handpicked from the stinky boats of the shores of Galilee piously looked her way and said, just send her away. The Bible says Jesus spoke up and said, I'm not sent to your kind. Now, that right there is a symbol of prejudice in this day and age and time. And there are words, you know, that we better not say that this was about the equivalent of it. I'm not sent to your kind. I'm sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But then something happened. Everybody say then. There has to be a then in your life. There has to be that moment that changes everything. Now, some of you have been going down this old dusty trail a while, and you've seen a lot of bumps in life. And sometimes, even more recently, I've found myself in the throes of such. And then for a moment, I would begin to complain a little bit, and it wouldn't last long. I would look at my wife, and I would say, you know what? I'm not going to get anywhere like that. And all of a sudden, with one word of complaint, all of a sudden there comes a word of commitment by way of worship and praise. The Bible said, then she came and worshiped him, saying, Lord, help me. Now, some of you, I fear you give up too easily. We know the kind of God we serve, and I'm not here implying that he has some heavenly ego that you can stroke his hair in a certain way, because he sees beyond the actions and he knows the heart. We know, and he knew the heart of Hezekiah. The Bible said, the gig is up, Doc. You're fixing to die. And Hezekiah went down the long list that merited him nothing of what he had done in his life for God, and the prophet still kept walking away. But you see, my Bible said when he got over himself and what he thought he had achieved in life or what he thought he had accomplished in life, and he said, you know what, God, a dead man won't praise you. And so that was a then moment in Hezekiah's life that turned the patter of the prophet departing around and came back to this man that previously was dying. I don't find many times where God ever changed a word of a prophecy, but worship will change everything. When you have a then moment in your life that God, in spite of all that seems to be against me, complaining and wallowing like a worm in ashes, is not going to change, but worship will make everything change. Worship will change everything in your life. Hallelujah. The Bible said we know Joshua had a moment that was a God moment. It wasn't about him or his. We knew that when Moses left the tent of meeting, we see in the Bible that Joshua lagged behind. I know my leader's gone, but to get to where he is, I might have to stay a little longer. And as a result of that, Joshua learned one thing, that he served a powerful God. But some of you give up too easy in your predicaments. Joshua found himself in a battle, and the Bible said the sun was about to set. And all of a sudden, he said to himself, he said, you know what? If I had a little bit more time, God, I think I can make this moment matter a little more. But you see, some of you are not making your moments matter. You're wallowing in the sidelines of life, and you're in the throes of the thorns and thistles, and you're patty caking to a different song and to the beat of a different drummer. But Joshua looked up, and in the boldness of what many of you, I believe, are going to operate in before you leave, and he said, son, be still. He still kept fighting. He still kept depending on God. But he told the sun to stand still, and my Bible tells me the sun stayed there for a course of time. I wish some of you would look at your problem and say, be still in Jesus' name. Hang on a moment. You'll be here when I get back home. But right now, I want to praise the Lord. I want to war and worship just a little bit longer today. Worship will make the difference. We find little nasty David with dung on his shoes, forgotten by all of those in his own family. Now, how can you be a good daddy and forget your own boy? I know history says that, you know, we weren't really sure that David was Jesse's boy. Maybe that's the reason why he was forgotten. But Samuel said, is this it? because all the ones that were head and shoulder above all the rest had already paraded before. God's not looking for that. And I don't care how long you've been in this thing. I don't care how much heritage and pedigree you think you have. Some of you have been in the way a long time. You've been in the way of revival. You've been in the way of miracles. You've been in the way of sign. But there are some today that are by-stepping all the protocol and principles of the kingdom that are just raising hands, don't even know what to do with themselves, and just saying, God, I want to be used by you, God. I know what my circumstance indicates, God. I know what others have said of me, God. But what does your word say? The word says, I'm going to raise up a people that were no people at all, and I'm going to make the people of God jealous. This little David, little bastard child David, because David said, in sin I was born and shaping him. And he gave a little clue as to Jesse really wasn't his daddy. But God looked past all of that. And you see, there was the curse of the bastard child in the Bible. I'll be PG. But it says 10 generations had to pass. But you look in there, and some say there was only 9. But there was a set of twins, because God needed to expedite. Because David, the one that worshiped God like no other, that was making love to him and love songs on a hillside by himself, and playing his little harp with nobody around. Some of you got to have the ivories, and some of you got to have the beat of the drum. But let me tell you something, like it was in the office last night, all of a sudden the Spirit of God slipped in that place. Tears began to leak out of my eyes, because I realized, and know, he didn't have to choose me, but he saw me in the predicament of my moment and reached down and found a worshiper of old that said, God, in spite of who I am and where I've been, I'm going to praise the Lord. I wish somebody helped me praise him this morning. Hallelujah. It was this David that changed the very law and mind of God, that built the tabernacle with no veil. Ooh. So that any moment of the night he could get up and look from the balcony of his house and see the flicker of the blue flame of God. And some of you need to get a glimpse of the fire this morning. The Bible said she worshiped him, and you could tell his mood and mind at that moment begin to change a bit. Because he began to make excuses, and he answered her worship with this. Now you know I can't give the children's bread to dogs. You know, it sounds like a mama when we have bent her will and way. Now, you know this ain't right. My mama used to always say, but because you're mine. And she said, Lord, you're right. You got me. You know me. I can't lie to you. I am a dog. I have been addicted. I have been an alcoholic. I have been a byproduct of domestic abuse and verbal abuse. You're right, God. You got me. I'm just a dog. But then she took it a step further and said, but even the dogs get the crumbs that fall from the master's table. You see, something at that moment began to be stirred in him. And then Jesus said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith. But really, he really was saying in between all the lines, great is thy hunger. Are you with me today? That crumb that you were hungry for, you got it, little girl. That daughter you wanted to be healed as a byproduct, that nothing could deter you and nothing could get your attention outside of the realm of, because you worshiped me and I didn't turn you away once, and you decided, all right, he's not in the mood for me right now. But there's some of you, you feel like you've been postponed. But I'm here to tell you today, you hadn't been denied. If you will worship God in spite of what you're feeling, in the face of what you face right now, I don't care how adverse it is, if you'll decide, I'm going to be a worshiper of him. My Bible tells me this. He don't even hear the prayer of a sinner. Everybody say, uh-oh. But if any man... No, doesn't matter what color, creed, or kind. If any man will become a worshiper of him, the Lord will begin to hear. Are there any worshipers in the house this morning? I figured out a long time ago, you simply cannot offend a hungry man. And the reason some of you stay offended is you're simply not hungry anymore. I've never found a panhandler that was a real panhandler that would turn down McDonald's. I've never met anybody on the street begging for food that would turn their nose up at a good old Whopper from Burger King. Some of you just like, oh, that don't even sound, because you ain't hungry. Let me move on. I wonder what would happen today. Jesus tried to offend her. He did his best, Brother Randy. He did his best to get beyond the veneer, and this is where we're going to dig today, beyond the veneer. Beyond the veneer of what you think everybody thinks of you and what you want everyone to think of you. Jesus got beyond the veneer by trying to offend her. And I wonder what would happen today if he started stating the obvious concerning you. Oh, y'all got real quiet on me right there. Elvis left the building, I fear, today. But I wonder what would happen if he marched down your aisle and looked you in the eye and said, you know what your problem is? You're cold and indifferent. Now, some of you right there was, I'm going to a different church. And yeah. I wonder what would happen if he tapped you on the shoulder and whispered ever so kindly and said, you know what your problem is? You're complacent. Oh, we're getting real this morning, aren't we? I wonder what would happen if he got you alone away from everyone else and said, you have feet that are swift to run to mischief. Oh, yeah. You ever notice something? Folks that are of the same mindset can always be caught hanging around each other. Always over here and over there, but the core and the crux, they'll be at his feet. Well, let me quit. I wonder what would happen if he looked at you and said, you don't even savor the things of God. Boy, y'all leaving me this morning, ain't you? We just preaching. You make way too many excuses. Uh-oh, now we're getting down here. And you miss way too much. I wonder what would happen. I'll tell you what would happen. We'd get offended. That's why the Bible said, blessed is he who is not offended in me. In other words, you get it back to the original translation. It says, blessed is he who's not offended in the way that I do my business. And I'm going to tell you something. He's doing some business in deep waters right now. And there's some nets being casted far and abroad right now. And let me tell you, you get a wide net, you're going to get every creature, every color, every kind. But I'm just here to tell you, this Holy Ghost ain't reside only for you and your little prim and proper self. It is for every color, every creed, every kind, every walk of life, whether they know anything about him or not, God is reaching beyond the borders of the house of God. He tried to offend her, but her response to offense was the grumble within. I get tickled sometimes as we have meetings around here, and you always know when the meeting's about over because you hear a little roar from deep within. We look at each other like, my Lord, was that you? Sound like a lion caged up inside of you. And we always know it's time to postpone and go to lunch. Her stomach replied, I know you're telling me I'm a dog and I'm not disagreeing. I'm not even here to take the whole loaf today, Master. I surely don't want on my conscience little children going unfed without bread. I don't want to cheat anyone out of the bread of blessing. But I know today, O Lord of hosts, that same DNA that is in the loaf is in the crumb. All I need is a crumb. The same oil's in there and the same flour is in there. The same power, the same blood, the same name, the same spirit, the same stripes that healed you. I'm here to tell you, you might just want a crumb today, but in the crumb is the DNA of everything that you need right now in this place. Don't you dare criticize the way a starving man eats. My mother-in-law, I get tickled at her. She can smack while she eats, but if the guy 10 rows down is smacking, it gets all on her nerves. Now, don't get in too big a hurry. I'm going to need a little room to land on that. You look pretty this morning. I appreciate it. She said stop because I'm in trouble. She can clip her toenails, but let somebody down the way. Don't you? Oh, yeah, I am live. Sorry. Don't you ever complain about the way a starving man eats or the way he smacks his lips with the crumbs that fall from the master's table. Because my Bible tells me in Matthew 5 and 6, blessed are they which do presently hunger and thirst after righteousness. Because my Bible says they're the ones that are going to, I'm not worried about how long you've been in it or what you used to do or what happened in 1962. I'm here to tell you in 2023, there is a revival like we've never seen before that is blowing across this terra firma that we call earth right now. And it's reaching for the young and those that we gave up on a long time ago, and God is trusting them. You want to know why? Because there's a grumble that says, you know what? I'm tired of church in and church out. I'm sorry, praise team. Y'all did good this morning. They left you hanging, but I tried. Just not hungry. You with me? But I feel there's a rumble in our little tumbly like Winnie the Pooh, and we want more than honey this morning. We want to drink from the fountain and the spout of God today because we are tired of church in and church out. We are weary with going through the motions. We need the Lord of hosts to come among us. He's looking for the hungry. We have laid down in green pastures for years. We've been led beside still waters. Our soul has been restored. We've been led in paths of righteousness we don't deserve, but because of his name's sake, he did it. We've made it through the valleys of the shadows of death, and we've been made to fear no evil because we know he's with us. But the problem is he's prepped a table before us in the presence of enemies. He's anointed our head with oil, and our cup runs over with goodness and mercy that follows us. And like Israel of old, we wake up every morning, step outside our proverbial tents, and we are greeted by heaven's bread. And the Bible says in Numbers 11 and 6, they complain, manna again? Now, where I'm from, my mama was ghetto. She invented the chancla, yeah, but it was usually a boot. Are you with me? Don't you dare roll up on her and say, is this what we're having for supper tonight? Because probably you would go to bed without. And like the prodigal son's brother, we have access to all Father has. But as soon as somebody else gets hungry, we get a bad spirit and turn our nose up and grumble, where's my feast? You with me? But Daddy was quick to speak up in this setting, and he said, you know what? You're right. You have served me for many years, but you've been too busy being Martha and not being Mary, and Mary has chosen the good part. So today, don't you dare complain when a sinner or backslider walk into this place and bypass kingdom protocol and start lapping up the crumbs from the floor of our altar area and spend the entire service on their face while you sit up here in pride, ready to go after 5 minutes. Sorry, guest, I'm usually nicer, but anyway. Can't wait to get back home to stupid that you was wanting to leave just a little bit earlier. When a miracle is under the table, but the problem is, like David when he sent for Mephibosheth, the Bible said Mephibosheth was dropped in life because the kingdom had been stripped from his father's and he was lame on both feet. But David made a promise to Jonathan of old that he would take care of his. And he asked, is there any left of this lineage? And they said, oh, yeah. There's one over there called Mephibosheth. And then they went, but he's lame on both feet. And when Mephibosheth got into the presence of King David, he said, oh, dead dog, I am. He just realized it. But after years of putting them little crooked feet up under the king's table, the spirit of Saul crept in. And he started operating in a sense of, this is what I deserve. You see, some of us think because we have incurred the passing of time that we deserve things. But we find in the Bible of old that he bypassed, he came unto his own received him not. But as many as did, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God. He's looking for the hungry this morning. Nelson Mandela was wrongfully imprisoned, food shoved under his prison cell door like a dog on a plate. But the prison made the president of South Africa, and some of you, life has attempted to humble you so heaven could help you. But here we sit haughty and hopeless because, like Saul, we have become a legend in our own mind. You ever seen? I like those shirts. Daddy, the myth, the legend, and you know, my daddy can do anything. My daddy can beat up my daddy is bad all by himself. Are you with me today? Joseph tried that pious route to promise, you're all going to bow, even mom and dad. But we see this chosen child with a coat of colors became the chastised child from pit to prison and eventually to palace because it was hunger that drove him. In prison, he honed his skills and gifts with the baker and the butler. And in parting, we see him screaming, don't forget me. And for years, it seemed the butler did. But one night in Pharaoh's nightmare, it became his niche because it was hunger that helped him. You see, I've had enough incurred bruises of life, and many of my even leaders have said of me, I don't even know how you do it, son. But I'm going to tell you how this morning. It's real simple. You just got to stay hungry, my friends, because that's what God is looking for in this hour. Are you with me? When God opens a door, no man can shut. But some of you don't understand, everything in the kingdom runs backwards. A seed must die and be buried in the ground in order to bear fruit. If you exalt yourself, you'll be abased. If you abase, you'll be exalted. Even Jesus said, I've come to give life. And later he died, because the cost of life is death. But the problem with so many is we love ourselves too much to die. You with me? Ooh, we pedicures, I'm not preaching against that, and get our nails did. You cut too short, that's why you had no boyfriend. Yeah. And we like it when they just rub that lotion on, and man, we'll make it a once a week, once a month appointment. But you see, we love ourselves too much to die, and that's why our dreams dissolve. Because we start operating under the auspice, I deserve this. When someone says that, I just cringe, because I'm going to tell you what we really deserve. We deserve death and hell. Are you with me? He knows what you're going through is painful and also personal. But pain is the prep for promise. And sometimes the fallow ground has to be broken up, and your clods have got to get busted. It doesn't seem right, but it is necessary. Why? Because he wants to see if you can stay hungry in the hell. Are you with me? I can't tell you how many times in my life I have heard those that should have been for me, my peers, Brother Kenneth, my preacher friends, that said, man, just find you a good place somewhere and just fall in and just serve. And I did. I wasn't too good for that. But all the while, there was a groan deep within that said, you know what? This ain't it. And then all of a sudden, others began to believe that it wasn't it. And they began to speak up for me and not against me anymore. And I'm here to tell you something. If you want someone to get hungry, then you better get hungry yourself. You better get so hungry you was glad when they said to me, it's church time. It's prayer time. It's work time. You got the strength to do everything else. It's amazing. It's amazing, but I'm going to tell you something. There's coming a time soon when I will stand before him, and you will too, and I will remind every time I pulled for you. Job didn't realize he was already out in chapter 23 when he said, I don't know how he found the strength to do it. I'm going to be real with you. Lost children and livestock and house and home, and even the one he was married to. Some of you, it's the one you married to. That's a problem. And I better quit. Let me look back here so I don't make eye contact. But even the one he was married to said, you just need to curse God and die. In the midst of all of that, he said, you know what? When he's finished, not you, when he's finished, I'm going to come out of this thing better than what I went into it. He said, I'm going to come out as pure gold. But it wasn't until chapter 42 of Job, verses 12 through 17, that the Lord said of him, the Lord blessed the latter end of yokes of oxen and 1,000 she asses and 7. This didn't happen overnight. You don't have 7 kids in 7 months. You don't get thousands of what you lost overnight. And I'm here to tell some of you don't even realize that gradually God is doing all along what you've been praying for him to do. He's just wanting you to stay hungry. If he gave it all to you at once, you'd probably misplace it and misappropriate it. But some of you done been to hell and back. And on this side of all of it, let me tell you, there's a thankfulness in your heart. And you say to yourself, it was good for me that I was afflicted. Had my nest not been stirred, I would have died in my comfort. Hallelujah. I feel the Lord in this place. Stay with me. I'm almost done. Job prophesied his own promise while presently in his pain. Ooh. I don't know how, but this is what he said. Naked I came, naked I shall return. The Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. And he could have ended right there, but he didn't stop there, baby. There was another verse to the song. He said, blessed be the name of the Lord. If it ain't going well, he's blessed. If it ain't going like you planned it, he's blessed. If it ain't going like you wished it would, bless the name of the Lord, because he is good anyway and altogether lovely, David said. Abraham experienced the death of his own ideas, but it was in his dying Isaac lived. And in the process, he caught a glimpse of Calvary. Isaac was asking questions he didn't really have an answer to, but in the prophetic realm, he began to operate. Where's the sacrifice? We got wood, Dad, and we got the fire, but where's the lamb? He said, the Lord is going to provide himself a lamb. And from that mountain, it was the very mountain that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was crucified upon. But he caught a glimpse because his hunger allowed him to see things at the naked eye. That's why the Bible said, eye hadn't seen, an ear hadn't heard what God has in store for them that will fall in love with him again. And as a result of his hunger, Israel came out of bondage 400 and something years later, and they inherited a promised land that he never got to see. And I want you to hear me this morning, and I'm getting ready to close. Your pain is the prep work for your promise. But it's a promise that only the hungry can handle and hold on to. Isaiah 53 and 10 said it pleased him to bruise him and put him to grief and make his soul an offering for sin. Why? Here's why. So that his seed could have prolonged days and prosper. Mama, what you're going through right now is not about you. I know you feel like you're shouldering up to it all right now, but it's about them little trees that stand under the shadow of your outstretched arms. So keep them stretched high toward the sun and keep praising him in spite of the pain, because the pain is going to prepare you and your seed to live some prolonged days. And that's why David said, I'm going to dwell in the house of the Lord. For let me tell you, I'll go through what I'm going through for him any day. I'll keep fighting the fight of faith for them three girls of mine. They may not be doing right now, but I'm just believing that my Bible said it's for you and your children, as many as the Lord our God shall call. Ooh, I gotta hurry. Said all that to say this: God's got a plan for your pain. And oftentimes hunger is about the hurting, as was the case for the four leprous men in 2 Kings chapter 7. The Bible said there were four leprous men at the entering into the gate, and they said one to another, why sit we here until we die? Only you can answer that. If we say we'll enter into the city, the famine's still in the city, and we'll die there. If we sit here, we're also going to die. So let's just fall into the host of the Syrians. If they save us, good. If they don't, we're just going to but die, the Bible said. But really, in all reality, they were saying we're going to die anyway. The whole earth has got a famine going on, and their stomachs groaned and growled, and they resided within themselves. I may die at the hand of an enemy, but Brother Randy, I'm not going to sit right here and die. Are you with me? Some of you, if you ain't careful, you're going to die in your sickness. If some of you ain't careful, you're going to die on the couch. If some of you ain't careful, you're going to die in your dilemmas. If some of you don't get up and reside in yourself, the enemy might take me out, but I'm not going to be still right here and die. I'm going to bow up my fist and roll up my sleeves, and I'm going to put the promises to proof of old that if God is for me, nothing and nobody can be against me today. Praise the Lord. I'm hurrying. Everybody say, I'm not going to sit here and die. I'm going to be found on the playing field of life. I'm not going to sit here and die. I'm not going to wring my hands and soil my pillows. And I might, weeping may endure for a night, but baby, when I get up in the morning and that sun rises and I see it, joy is coming in the morning and mercy has been made new for me. So they rose up at twilight and they went into the camp of the Syrians. And when they were coming to the uttermost part of the camp, the Bible said there was no man there. because the Lord had made the host of the Syrians. It wasn't this, but the Lord made hunger sound like this. The Lord made hunger sound like chariots and the noise of horses, even a great noise of great hosts, as though they hired against them the Hittites and all of the Egyptians to come. And what happened here this morning is their hunger began to sound like heaven had hired a hitman. Stay with me. I'm going to prophesy to some of you in this place this morning, if you would let your hunger go and allow yourself to get lost in this situation, then the sound of the hungry would be made into the noise of a host that is against your enemy, disease and sickness. And some people just don't want to get up. They don't want to be healed, because if they are, then they're going to have to do something for the kingdom of God. But I'm here to tell you right now, I'm not preaching to them today. I've wasted enough time. I'm preaching to the hungry this morning. I'm preaching to those on the playing field. I'm preaching to those that have been in the prayer room. I'm preaching to those that have been fasting and were here all day Saturday to get some things accomplished in the kingdom. When the lepers, everybody say the lepers, when the sinners came into the uttermost part of the camp, they went into one tent and did eat what God's people did not, and carried silver and gold and raiment, and then they went in again to another. Everybody say a double portion, a double portion. You see, your hunger is going to scatter your enemy, and you're going to get back like Job what you lost. But don't be satisfied with one tent, because I serve a two-tent blessing God. And some of you get satisfied. I've heard some of you say, I just want to pay my bill. I don't go to work just to pay my bills. I believe in good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. God said, men are going to give to you because they're going to see the favor of God upon your life. Stand with me. I'm done. There's a noise of hunger among us. And I'm going to give some of you some sound advice. Don't get in the way of a hungry man. They will absolutely run you over and down. My Bible says Elisha was a powerful man that filled valleys with waters and healed Naaman and cursed Gehazi with leprosy and led an entire Syrian army, this very army, blind into the camp of the Lord. It said there was a famine in the land and Elisha was ready to be used. I know, because every man of God is, by the hand of God. But I want to drive home to you this morning, as we get ready to go home in just a little bit, that God chose four leprous outcast men because of their hunger to bring victory to Israel. And in this end time that we find ourselves in the throes of, God will use the hungry to make such a noise that the enemy will retreat. You see, some of you starting out like Hezekiah. You want to throw up what you've done, how faithful you've been, and what you've given. And God's like that woman that was a dog. He'll just keep right on passing by, watching the waves and the wind blow. But he's looking for somebody in the midst of this boat we call the ship of Zion that will cry out to him in their hunger, because there is a noise that the hungry make that we have seen on the internet and on live television, and we've caught glimpses of it in this place. But I wonder, are the hungry among us in this place this morning? Before we go home, I'm going to give you a chance. I wonder today. I know how long you've lived for him. I've been your pastor for 10 of those years. Some of you I pastor. But some of you I really do pastor. But whether I pastor or pester you, this word is right today. And you're not going to tell me that going through the motions that many of you have been going through, that anything is going to, has it changed? It's not going to change. Because God is looking for heartfelt repentance to lay across the altar and say, you know what, God, I'm like Solomon of old. I don't even know how to go out or come in. I can't chew gum and walk at the same time. But God, with you, Lord, we need the Lord of hosts a whole lot worse than we're giving ourselves and him credit for in this hour. And revival is happening. But I wonder, can you stay hungry? Can you stay? are the hungry among us today. If you are, I want you to, if you ain't, just stay where you're at. I won't judge you. I'll just turn around if I need to. But if you're hungry, I want you to step out from where you're standing right now, because we cannot take lightly this revival that God is blessing us with. We can't take lightly this end time hour and move of God that God has graced us with. Let me tell you, I know there's some among us right now that have had the heartbeat of God. I heard it beating last night in this place as you lingered long. You wasn't worried about what happened next, and you wasn't worried about protocol that we forgot, but you had your heart tuned to Him and your ears plugged in, and you were saying to heaven, heaven, I need some help right now because my stomach is grumbling right now, God. And it's divine. Brother Randy, you said it right this morning. It's divine discontentment that God is rearing up on the belly of those. Some of you, your God's been your belly like the days of old have said, but some of you, God has become that grumble on the inside of your spiritual stomach right now, and is driving you to say things you never would, and to pray prayers you never would pray, and do things in the spirit that you never would do before. I wish hunger could happen in this place this morning. I wish the hunger could begin to make a sound, and that God would choose the most unlikely of creatures among us today that may have a past of this, riddled with the pain of this, and seasoned with seasons of life with a little dash of this, that today could begin to signal to heaven that I'm hungry right now, God. I want my family saved. I want my marriage saved. I want my situations changed, God. But if you don't change them, change me, because I'm hungry for revival. Listen to me, hungry folks. Listen to me, hungry folks. Don't you let the wet blankets and the sad sacks put out your fire this morning. You get a hold of God. Let them talk about you. Let them make fun of you. Let them call you holier than thou. Let them call you fanatics. Let them call you whatever they want to. But you get plugged into God. You get secure in Him. And let your confidence be found in Him. And you begin to set your sights on Him. And fix your heart towards heaven right now. And let God use you to turn upside down this city we call Stephenville right now. Hallelujah. I wish the hunger could arise right now. I wish some of you at the gate of your problem right now, and in the famine of your land, could say to yourself, I'm not going out like this. I'm going to get up off this bed of ease. I'm going to get out of this sick bed. I'm going to get off the couch. I'm going to get back to the house of God, and I'm going to raise my hands and let the Spirit of God have the final say so in the matter of my life right now. Come on, hunger. Come on, hungry. Come on, hungry. Oh, I hear the hoofs of horses. I feel the clanging of chariots that are shaking this place this morning, because your hunger is rumbling heaven right now. And the Lord of hosts has unseated Himself from the throne of glory, looking over the balcony of heaven towards you and yours, and is saying today, you know what, angels? I think they're ready right now. Let us go down and be among them. Oh, I wish hunger could talk right now. He knows what you're going through. He knows how the infirmity makes you feel. He's not a high priest that can't be touched, but He is looking for hunger that will signal towards heaven that, God, no matter what, Lord, I want revival. I want revival, God. I'm not going to die in my dilemma. I'm getting up today with the hunger of my spirit in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Brother Destin, come help me right now. Hallelujah. Come on, Samuel, let hunger talk this morning. I'm coming out of this. I'm getting over this. I may have some baggage of my past that I feel like gets the best of me. But the Lord said my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I need to shoulder up to Him and His this morning in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Oh, I hear hunger. Oh, I hear the rumbling of hunger in the place this morning.
Let the sons and the daughters,
I feel the anointing destroying yokes that previously bound you, but they are no match for you. Even an insignificant feeling leper a victory to this place that we've never seen before. It's not going to come from prophets. It's not going to come from preachers. It's not going to come from anything but by those that are hungry at the gate of their predicament, that will get up and move beyond it and let the Lord take control and make a sound that makes a difference. In Jesus' name, this morning. Oh, that's a beautiful sound. That's a beautiful sound of young people, old people raising hearts and hands toward God, saying, I'm still hungry, God. I'm still hungry today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Don't wait for the next conference to shout. God wants to see if you're hungry enough to shout it home. Hallelujah. 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 In the name of Jesus. Come rest among us, Almighty God, great God that you are. Give the weary warrior strength today and worship, God. Let them keep their eyes on you, lest we sink in the despair of what we now presently face. God, let a hunger arise that will push us from our bed of ease. And let Zion, real Zion, begin to travail. And let sons and daughters be born today in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Let the sons and the daughters sing.
Things and we're gonna get out of here. We live, I gotta preface this because we're online. Gotta behave now, sister. But sometimes I see some of the dumbest things that people, you know, yeah, internet's ate up with it. I saw a bucket list one time. And it was written by a backslider that just felt like everything on his list they couldn't do with God. And we looked at it, and I said, well, my God, I can do everything on that list with him. You with me? And I'm here to tell you this morning, and we live in a very pitiful generation, and I've about had enough. I was talking to a preacher the other day, and I wished I had a thought about it. But he said, you know what we're reaping now? We're reaping what was sowed in 2020. showing up late, leaving early, don't want to be around, and now they're in trouble and they want everybody around. And they're reaping the seeds that they planted. Yeah, that's truth right there. That's a big bomb. I dropped mic. I could leave right there. This is God's family. But you got to show up. Don't wait to be invited to something. You don't have to be petted and prompted to get here to prayer. This is a standing open invitation for everything that ever goes on. We will find you something to do. I'm glad I don't wake up waiting on some of y'all to call me and get me to church, because y'all probably wouldn't call me. Oh God, I hope somebody. This is God's family. But families are things that stick together through thick and thin. But the problem is, he said it, I didn't. He said, problem is we got so used to doing without, and now they need us, and nobody knows them, you know. And he said that. I didn't say it, but anyway, it's the truth. You got to show up and get involved and get plugged in, because these are the people that we're going to go to heaven with. But it's amazing. We don't want to worship with them. We won't talk in tongues, just not to each other. And I know I'm meddling now. This is God's house. This is God's family. And we've got to stir up a hunger deep within to get to God's house. Because I'm going to tell you something. There's not a one of you, not one of you in this place that God cannot use and will not use. And furthermore, we're the same, because we're striving to be like him. Get plugged in, get connected, get involved, get to prayer. Don't have to be bad. Get to God's house. You know what time service starts. And these announcements, I just get so beside myself, because we put it on the internet and we text all the ones that are not internet savvy. It's on our website. And Brother Randy sounds like a broken record up here. And still invariably somebody's going to say, I didn't know, because you won't look up. I said you won't look up. You with me? It's time to get involved and quit wearing me out, having to beg you and pet you and pamper you, and get to God's house, and let's get this harvest in. I wish the hungry folks would just shout amen with me right now. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, there was a few of you. God bless you. You're dismissed when you do one thing. If I have never met you, I'd love to meet you before you leave. But if you have to go, I understand. But in being dismissed, I want you to go find someone. I want you to look them in the eye. And I want you to say, I hear your stomach rumbling. God bless you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Shake hands and be friends. You.